Good evening, all of you. This is the first an introduction session to the GMAT test preparation from Wish to Mind. If anyone of you has already written the GMAT, you will understand quite a bit of whatever I'm saying. But if you have not taken GMAT before, if you have not really read through what exactly is in store for you for an exam like GMAT, it's a computer adaptive test, unlike many other exams that you have written, it is very, very useful to understand this exam while you start preparing for the same exam. Okay, so my entire endeavor today is going to kind of introduce you to the paper, introduce you to the exam as such, and then look at figuring it out of how we will take you through for the next 1.5-2 months of preparation, depending on, of course, if you're looking for the entire GMAT course or GMAT verbal course alone in that sense. Fair enough. First, I think it is very important. And this reason why we are also doing this class today is to kind of give you this comfort zone that at this time of the day, we spend about 1.5 hours over the next 1-1.5 months, 3 days a week kind of things. And my bet is you would be pretty much ready at least in terms of ability to attempt the exam. Of course, getting marks is a slightly, getting the right kind of score is a function of a lot of other areas also, which we will try to address. Okay, that's going to be my endeavor. Those of you already know me, that's fine, and hello. And those of you do not know me, my name is Arks, A-R-K-S Srinivas. I'm the CEO of Vistamind, and I've been training students for CAT, GRE, GMAT for the last 17 odd years. And also, I said, my endeavor in this particular GMAT course, our endeavor is not just to kind of, you know, take classes, but also to guide you through the kind of business schools that you need to get into, the B schools that you want to get into, the possible counseling that is required, the statements of purpose that you will write, the essays for various institutes that you will write. I think it's a kind of a comprehensive plan that we plan to give. I also will have a colleague with me who will join us, not today, but as we go along for your, specifically for B school admissions. And she is a past student of mine. Her name is Pragnya. She will also help in the counseling. She is a graduate from Wharton Business School, Pennsylvania. Okay, so that's with that very, very brief thing. Let me start off the classes right now. Just quickly, let's understand GMAT. This is the structure of the GMAT exam. I guess all of you know this, but it might be a good idea to kind of revisit this very quickly. It's a totally a 3.5 hour exam, close to a 3.5 hour exam. Okay, 75, 150 minutes plus 60. Just a second. So as I said, as you can clearly see, this exam is not just an exam of quantitative ability or a verbal ability areas. You will have to spend 3.5 hours. Almost those of you who have written CAT, you will understand that 3 hours itself is a long time with three sections. Here we are talking about sections like verbal ability and quantitative ability for 75 minutes at a stretch. And of course, there is integrated reasoning and analytical writing assessments too. Though they don't really count in your scores, when you talk about the GMAT score on 800, only the quantitative section and the verbal section are picked up and, you know, taken into consideration. It is definitely useful to have a decent score in both integrated reasoning and analytical writing assessment too, especially AWA, because we are discussing analysis and analysis of an argument really. And arguments are, in fact, typical arguments are already given on the GMAT original website itself in that first place. As you can see here, there are 37 questions in quantitative ability, which when you get the answers, the scores that the raw scores that you get are the raw scores that you get are in the range of 0 to 60. Actually, it is not really 0 to 60. It's almost like 10 to 60. But typically, that is what we are talking about when we discuss the quantitative section. Similarly, verbal ability, there are 41 questions and the score also ranges between 0 to 60. You will almost see no such raw score beyond 50 to 53 at all, either in the quantitative section or in the verbal section when it comes to the actual raw scores that the students get. But even before we get into understanding this area, one fundamental difference between GMAT and almost every other competitive exam, especially Indian competitive exams, whether it's CAT or any other exams, are the fundamental difference is that you cannot leave a question unanswered in the paper. The questions will be easier, much, much more easier than probably a CAT exam. I presume some of you or quite a lot of you would have written the CAT exam. But the difference is in the CAT exam, if you don't get a few questions, you can easily skip them. You can easily skip them, and your final score is dependent only on the number of corrects that you get, on the number of final corrects, and of course negative marks if you remove the negative marks that you get. Whereas what you will also find today in this GMAT structure and the scoring pattern is that leaving out questions is going to penalize you a lot more than getting the questions wrong. We'll talk about it as we go along. So let's understand 37 questions in quant, 41 questions in verbal. I'm sticking myself to these two areas because understanding this will be of very, very huge importance as we go along preparing for this exam itself. So let's look at what marks and what scores happen. Here is what you need to understand: the raw scores and the percentiles that one gets. As you can see very clearly, in quantitative ability, if you get 51 to 60 as the raw score, your percentile will be 99. But if you get 50, you're talking about getting 89 percentile. It shows that a lot of people get 50 plus. 89 percentile, those of you understand percentile, means that you are in the top 10. If you are 90 percentile, that means you are in the top 10, or 90% of them are below you, or 89% students writing the exam are below you. It will be very interesting to know that Indians, the average mean score of Indians in GMAT is higher than a lot of countries, including the US. I think Singapore, probably United Kingdom, UK, Singapore. These are the two countries where the mean score of the GMAT mean score may be slightly more than that of Indians mean score, Indian students mean score. But then you need to also realize that about 30,000 Indians write the GMAT score every year. In that sense of the word, chances are that our performance in GMAT, I'm talking about Indians' performance in GMAT, is very decidedly better off than a lot of other business school, a lot of other countries' performances. And very interestingly, you need to also know this, that getting a 700 score in GMAT is considered very, very good across the world. Of course, you want to get into an ISB, you want to get into in some of the big, good schools in the US or in Europe, you will need that 700 plus. We'll talk about that 700. 700, as you can clearly see, is 89 percentile. You need to be in the top 10 percentile of the batch. 89 percentile is not difficult if you prepare well for this exam. You will be surprised. By the way, this verbal score that I am showing here, 35 verbal score you get a 75 percentile. But at 40, the difference is just 5 marks. In fact, I'm going to give you some very interesting scores on the quant side and could be extrapolated to verbal also, that you need just about 40 out of 60. That means out of 41 questions, the number of questions that you need to get right will be a very shocking thing for you. It will be very less to get that 90 percentile. But then those people who know this will plan their exam much better as they go along. Okay? So, as I said, this is the actual exam pattern and the kind of scores that one needs to get. Obviously, guys, there is zero doubt about it in my mind that when you are preparing for any exam, whether it be GMAT, whether it be CAT or anything else, the aim has to be pretty high. You need to look at a 750 plus. And can you get 750 plus? And that's my job today to tell you how. Okay. Important points for GMAT scoring. This is something very, very important. And it might be useful to remember this when we are writing the exam as well. Of course, for preparation, you may not need it because you want to get everything right. But when you are actually writing the GMAT exam, I'll come back to this again and again when we actually do the papers, saying that if you are doing 10 questions, how many should I get correctly so that I'll get a very, very good score? First and foremost, the GMAT is like the best, you know, the way the questions are designed and the way the questions come to you, it's a computer adaptive test. We discussed this. Since it's a computer adaptive test, it is trying to adapt to your level. So it starts giving you average level of difficulty questions. Every paper starts with an average level of difficulty, meaning the first few questions, maybe the first two, three questions are, in its understanding, average level. It could be a sentence correction question, it could be a reading comprehension question, it could be a critical reasoning question. Incidentally, the marks are graded according to these three areas also. So they also know this, that more people will get more mistakes in sentence correction than, let's say, in critical reasoning, and in between you will get, of course, in reading comprehension. The brilliant algorithm that the GMAT uses understands this because of the vast number of data points they have for on which they have scored. So you start with an average level of difficulty, and progressively the level of questions start becoming either difficult or easy depending on whether you are answering them correctly or not answering them correctly. Depending on the accuracy level, the next level of questions unveil themselves. What they are trying to do is, okay, you think that you are good. First question, you get it right. First few questions, you get it right. Then the GMAT gives you such questions which kind of tries to say that, oh, boss, this guy is a 650 level guy. No. He seems to be a 700 level guy. No. He seems to be a 750 level guy. So they progressively increase the level of difficulty in the questions that come in. Very interestingly, more corrects that you get, you will get more difficult questions, but mind you, you will also get a higher score on that. That is important, which is very, very important to figure out. You need to realize this, that getting difficult questions means that your level is getting very, very clearly ascertained. I'm not saying there is a myth about GMAT. There has been this perpetuating myth about GMAT that the first few questions or the first seven questions determine your final score. To an extent, it is right, but not completely. In the sense that the myth is something like this. After the first seven questions, whatever you do for the next 30 questions in quant, your scores will be not changing too much kind of things. True only to an extent. Because in the first 10 questions, in the first 10, 15 questions, the GMAT adaptive test is trying to ascertain your level. And after that, once it adapts to your level, it starts giving you similar level of questions. Example, I'll give you an example. Let's say it decides that you are a 700 level of guy. By giving you 750 level questions, by giving you 650 level questions, by giving you 800 level questions, by giving you 600 level questions in terms of levels of difficulty. And it realizes that the moment a very difficult question comes in, you are getting it wrong. And the moment it's an easier question, you are getting it correct. So it kind of slowly reduces the, narrows down the level of difficulty to a certain level, which you will keep getting the similar kind of things. In between, you will also get rewarded for easier questions too. It is not that it is only difficult questions which will come to you. There are rewards too. Easier questions are also given if one answers difficult questions. It's just a bait saying that you have done well, therefore you will get more marks. But the penalty for getting easier questions wrong in easier questions is higher than the penalty for getting a higher level of difficulty question. Understand this. We will also talk about very, very interestingly certain things I will tell you about number of questions that you need to get the scores. As I said, GMAT is trying to figure out your level through these questions. Now, couple of very interesting points. Penalty for consecutive mistakes is more than penalty for the same number but with non-consecutive mistakes. Example, let's say you have 37 questions in the quant section. Let's say you get 10 mistakes. If these 10 mistakes are in continuous succession, consecutive, you will get a higher level of penalty in total marks. Whereas these 10 are spread across, the 35-7 questions, chances are you will get a much better score. And that is very, very important. In that sense of the word, what does this mean? You need to understand this. You need to realize that you cannot, when you talk about consecutive mistakes, you cannot leave questions unanswered till the last. Because at that point of time, there is a very big possibility. Let's say you have 75 minutes and you have 37 questions. So let's say you have reached only 30 questions at the 72nd, 73rd minute. Because of the pressure in time, you will start answering them quickly. And there is obviously a higher possibility that you will get them wrong. That they want, the GMAT guys want to avoid. In other words, please understand that GMAT is an exam, testing exam for becoming managers of tomorrow. It's probably the most comprehensive exam that I think exists in the world itself. So they are trying to figure out how do you utilize these 75 minutes properly without rushing into the last 7-10 questions fast or doing a lot of mistakes in the beginning and having too much of time at the end too. Both ways it is wrong. Even saying that, look, I have about 2 minutes for each question and therefore every 2 minutes I'll go to the next question is also wrong because not every question is of same level of difficulty. So it's a complex mixture of easier questions, difficult questions. The time that you need to give it to easier questions and difficult questions will vary so that overall you need to get your good scores. As I said already, penalty for leaving questions unanswered more than the penalty of getting questions wrong. In fact, we have done this experiment in various ways. Just look at this. If you get 37, there are 37 questions. If there are 37 questions, let's say somebody gets 30 correct. I'm just giving you an example. 30 correct and 7 unanswered versus 30 correct and 7 wrongs. This guy will get a lesser score than this guy. Even if the last 7 questions that you make are wrong, this guy, the guy who is doing 30 correct and 7 wrong, will get a higher score than a guy who gets 30 correct all right, but 7 unanswered questions. Once you understand this, if you notice, there are two levels of understanding GMAT, guys. The reason why GMAT is difficult is not because the questions are difficult. It is, yes, the questions are not that easy, especially the verbal part of it. Quant may be, the problem solving is easy, may not be the data sufficiency. But what is necessary to understand while we are doing all these things is to make sure that you adapt to the paper. The way you attempt the paper will become very, very important. There is no one correct strategy for it. You need to decide who you are, what kind of a level you are, and then we can look at it also. As I said very clearly, there is no ideal number of correct answers required to get this is very interesting, the last sentence. There is no ideal number of correct answers required to get a particular score. You will be surprised. Out of the 37 questions, somebody gets 20 correct can get the same marks as somebody who's getting 25 correct. Same score, that is. How does it? This is a simple information on questions and raw scores, which you might just be very interested to know. This is something for you to, you know, give it a thought. Look at this. Look at this. Somebody getting between 12 to 17 correct can get a raw score of 10 to 15. Remember, the raw score is on 0 to 60. And similarly, somebody who gets 12 to 13, which 12 to 13 they get, they can get a raw score between 16 to 20 also. So, technically speaking, theoretically speaking, a guy who gets 12 can get 20 also, and a guy who gets 12 can get 10 also. And that's really, really true, by the way. That's really, really true. We have checked this, we have seen this. Similarly, look at this. Somebody who gets between 15 and 21 can get anything between 26 and 30. And the same guy between 15 and 21 in any other set can get 36 to 40. Technically speaking, somebody gets 21 can either get 30 raw score or can get even 37, 38 kind of thing raw score. This is real. And the same thing, another set of 19 to 23. You can see somebody gets 21 can get only 41 or 42, or somebody who gets 21 can get 46 also. Why is this? Because we do not know which of these scores are that somebody is getting. For example, there are 37 questions. Which 19 are you getting them correct? Which 21 are you getting them correct? Are there more consecutive mistakes, or are there less consecutive mistakes? Have you finished all the 37 questions in the allotted time, or have you left certain questions unanswered? You know, all these questions bear a effect on the final score that you get. Here is the best thing that I can tell you about. A lot of people don't understand this, but the reality is, this is on 41. If you can get anything between 20 to 24 out of the 41 questions in verbal ability, mind you, that is just about more than half. You can get the raw score between 35 to 51. In fact, 24 to 27, 24, 25, 26 kind of correct. Not having too many consecutive mistakes, not having the first few questions going not going wrong, and not leaving out questions. If you can maintain these three things. I'm just repeating this. First few questions, you don't make mistakes. First 7-10 questions. Two, you don't get too many consecutive mistakes. And three, you don't make too many you don't leave too many unanswered questions. Not even one unanswered question at the end of the 75th minute. With 24 on 41, you can get as high as a 50 marks out of 60 raw score in verbal ability. Similarly, as you can clearly see, out of 37, getting 26, 27 correct, or if you can get up to 30 correct out of 37, and each one of you who is there on this class today, I think I can see that there are about 22 of you in the class today. Most of you are engineers. I'll be surprised if there is any non-engineer here. Maybe there will be one out of you. Is there any non-engineer? I mean, may I ask that also? But again, very, very unlikely, I see. You will see that getting 30 correct out of 37 or 28, 30 correct out of 37. In the GMAT, oh, we have Ranjan, one guy who's a non-engineer. I'm glad. At least one non-engineer we have, kind of things. You will see that getting that 27, 28 out of 37 will give you an 89 percentile. And that's very strong. Very, very good. And that means 50 marks almost. Somebody gets 50 on quant and about 35 in, I'll just go back to the numbers. If you look at this, if somebody gets something like verbal score of 37, and a 50 or a 51, a verbal score of 37 and a 50 or a 51 can easily get about 660 to 700 score. This and this I'm talking about. And the moment you get 40 and 50, you're talking about a guaranteed 700 plus score. Guaranteed 700 plus score. And anything more than 40 raw score in verbal, you can easily check 760, 770 kind of things. I would expect that some of you will get 51. And mind you, getting 51 score in quantitative ability means getting about 29, 30 correct out of 37. And trust me, out of these 37, there will be data sufficiency questions, but almost all problem solving questions, at least, you will crack them out of shape. Almost everyone will crack them out of shape if you spend 2 months of preparation on a, you know, consistent basis. I'm not even saying rigorous basis, a consistent basis in that sense. Is this clear, guys? I think some understanding of what the GMAT exam is, what are the scores, therefore what you need to get kind of things. This is what we will do for us, for you guys, in the next few days. Reading comprehension, there will be six classes, which will take you through, you know, the types of passages. We will talk about them, various kinds of types of passages, science passages, social passages, you know, that and the types of questions that come in. We will work on those things. Critical reasoning. Again, today's class, I'm going to spend a little time on these things of what is it that you need to prepare for, and sentence correction. What type of questions come in sentence correction? Together, we will do about 18 to 20 classes of just verbal ability, because there are, I think there is an issue here. This is 41 questions. Similarly, integrated reasoning also, there are only 12 questions. The marking is 1 to 8. Much, much more complicated is integrated reasoning marking, simply because there are, you know, in the same question, there could be part 1, part 2, more than one part to get them right kind of things. But again, it's more of data interpretation and logic, more of data interpretation, which we will work on. There is a 30-minute analytical writing argument. We will talk about certain arguments and how we construct or deconstruct an argument and make an essay out of it. We will discuss that also. And quantitative ability, just to give you an idea, what are the areas which are there in quantitative ability? You have basic arithmetic, basic algebra, numbers and number theory. This is something which is important. Statistics, probability, these two don't come in CAT, remember. We need to work on this. Statistics and probability are the two areas, and probably a bit of coordinate geometry does not come in the CAT exam. Though, so if you're preparing for CAT any which way, everything else becomes easier, except that one needs to prepare separately for these three areas. Everything else, of course, is easier. In fact, let me assure you that quite a lot of you will get a good score if your basics in 8th, 9th, and 10th are good. I'm not even going to the level of CAT. It is, you know, 50% level of CAT in that sense. But the problem in quant is not the problem-solving part, but the data sufficiency part. Here, the fundamentals are extremely, extremely important. Not only the fundamentals are important, one of the issues with data sufficiency is you tend to solve data sufficiency in an exam. Whereas that is not what you are expected to do in the first place. Because those of you know, understand what is data sufficiency, there is a question given to you and two statements given to you. The question does not have enough information. You know, some data is missing.
in data sufficiency, this data to solve this question is given in statement 1 or statement 2 or both together. Your job is to find out whether one alone, the statement 1 alone, is sufficient to answer this question, statement 2 alone is sufficient to answer this question, or do you require both of them to answer that question. There will also be an answer where even after taking both the statements, you can't still answer the question. That is the challenge. It is not about solving, it's about telling whether you can solve or not given the data. For example, if there's an equations question, you know that there are, if let's say there are a three variable equation. If you have a three variable equation, you will need three equations. If there are three variables, you need three equations, ideally, to solve. Solve for what? Solve for individual variables. Now the point is, the statement is question number, question could be, what is the value of x given that 3x plus 2y plus 4z is equal to 21. Some number is given. And statement 1, one statement is given, one more equation is given maybe, and statement 2, one more equation is given to me. Yet you can't say that, okay, there are three equations, three unknowns, and therefore I'll get my answer. Which is where I think fundamentals of equations, fundamentals of obviously arithmetic, percentages of profit and loss, so time, speed, distance, time and work, and of course quadratics and progressions will come in handy. So we will take care of the GMAT quant area to make sure that not only this area, the problem solving part is there, but more importantly, data sufficiency also is taken care of. This is just to quickly give you what are the topics which are there in the area, which all of you probably already know. In numbers and number theory, you need to understand properties of numbers, basics on integers, even, odd, integers, etc. Fractions and decimals. Not the level of, you know, remainder theorem, etc. doesn't come into picture here. In arithmetic, basics on ratios and proportions, basics on percentages, profit and loss, averages, simple interest, compound interest, time and work, time spent, instance. This is exactly same as any CAT or any exam. If you prepare for CAT, this will become seriously, seriously very, very easy. Similarly, if you look at algebra, there are, you need to know the basic formulae, you know, including what is a plus b whole square, a plus b whole cube, a cube plus b cube, what is it equal to, etc. kind of things. Then equations, I am taking it under linear equations, because then comes quadratic equations. No special equations are going to be given typically in GMAT exam. And basics of functions are given. In geometry and mensuration, again, this is, if you do this in CAT, GMAT will be really, really straightforward and simple. And of course, as I said very clearly, coordinate geometry is important. One area which is not given here is statistics and probability, which very, very important, because at least a mean, median, mode kind of things can come in your actual GMAT questions. If not in the problem solving area, but it can come in the data sufficiency area. Right? This is for sentence correction. For those of you who are really, really keen on verbal ability, that's where I think a lot of you will find a problem in. I have put together the most common errors that come in the GMAT exam. Unlike CAT, unlike any other exam, GMAT has always, for the last, I don't know, donkey's years, has given a very specific type of questions for you to answer. Therefore, the preparation for this also is very, very specific. You know, it is not that you need to start with a Renan Martin as such. You don't have to. As you can see clearly what I have put it here, the common errors which come in your GMAT, almost all the exams, is pronoun errors, misplaced. We will talk about each one of these. In fact, there will be enough top, you know, the classes, each class will take care of each type of errors that can come in, giving you the rules of it, application of the rules. You can understand how to apply these rules, and of course, elimination of what does not come through kind of things. So it is understanding of rules and application of rules, and more importantly, how to attempt the exam, attempt the question is what we will try to really, really get a lot more, in depth into. This particular area is one area which probably none of the directors will teach. This is seriously a verbal strong area, grammar strong area's problem, and we will make sure that the person who teaches, there are three people who will teach. One is, of course, there is one person in Calcutta called Sunita. There is one in Chennai called Suchitra ma'am, and we have Geeta ma'am in Mysore. Among between the three of them, we will ensure that all the sentence correction areas are handled. Then comes reading comprehension. Reading comprehension, as you can clearly see on the screen here, the types of passages which have come in your GMAT for the last few number of years is there are social sciences passages, science passages, and business passages. You will see that it's always this 3 to 4 passages come in, and you're talking about getting 11 to 15 questions or 11 to 14 questions in the exam. So there are 3 to 4 questions on an average, 4-4-4 or 4-4-3 or 4-4-5 also. Sometimes there are 4 passages also, but typically you will find that this is the kind of passages which are given. Similarly, types of questions that come in from each of these is inference based, which I think is there in CAT also. Style and tone based. See, again, if you look at it very clearly, these three are general questions where you will get the answer only if you read the entire passage. Whereas to a large extent, inference based questions is from the passage, a part of the passage, which are a lot more of specific questions. One of the ways in which we'll try to show you in the RC questions is not really to only tell you how to improve reading speeds, etc., kind of things which will, I don't know, in 1 month, 2 months, how much it can improve, but how to understand a question. First, reading the passage, what are the relevant parts of reading the passage, etc., will be talked about, but more importantly, you know, identifying what is it that we want. In fact, in a very, very broad sense, I'm making it very simple for you. In a very broad sense, figuring out whether you want a specific answer to that question or a general answer to the question. This one single differentiator can give you enough marks. Almost out of the 14, you can get almost 7, 8 easily right. And you can get more than that right, obviously. Ideally, you should get more than that right if your basics are strong. And the third area, of course, is critical reasoning. Once again, in critical reasoning, there are only 7 types of questions which have come in, which will come in, whether it is CAT exam or for that matter a GMAT exam. You need to understand what is the argument all about, because there is an argument given to you. An argument obviously has a premise, an assumption which you need to figure out, and of course a conclusion. Typically, just to give you a quick idea about it, for example, a premise, like I keep saying this, Sachin Tendulkar has scored the maximum runs in ODIs. Sachin Tendulkar has scored maximum runs in ODIs. He is the best batsman in the world. Let's say I give this. This is my argument. Simple argument which has 2 statements. Sachin Tendulkar has scored the maximum runs in ODIs. That is my premise. That is the fact. It is a fact. You have to take this as a real fact. Even tomorrow, Virat Kohli does more than this, you will consider that this is the highest. Whatever. Even if I tell you that McGrath has scored the maximum number of runs in ODIs, you will have to take it. Okay, boss, correct. He is the best batsman in the world. This is my conclusion. So you will see this, that on based on a premise, an argument is made. You prepare for GMAT, 6 weeks are required. Surekha prepared for GMAT for 6 weeks. She will get 720. Let's say, I'm just giving you an example. So here, there is a reasoning, there is a premise, which is a fact, and there is a conclusion drawn. You need to figure out what is the assumption on which this conclusion will be true. For example, in this particular case, we know that a person who scores the maximum number of runs in 1D internationals, if for example, the best batsman is a person who scores the maximum runs in 1D internationals. If this is the assumption, obviously my conclusion will be true. So in critical reasoning, the way we will go about trying to teach you is give you rules for each of these things. Not really, really rules as such, but these are kind of made up by us in terms of, you know, developed by us in terms of making it easier for you to figure out and eliminate most of the choices. Similarly, the question, what is the assumption? From this assumption or from the conclusion, how do you strengthen that argument by making the premise stronger? How do you weaken the argument by making the premise weaker or with some more information which will make the conclusion weaker? Inference based, it is more similar to what is a, you know, finding the actual conclusion. Paradox or a flaw in an argument. Trying to evaluate an argument which is more like your AWA also. And of course, there are questions which come in parallelism. Not really one question, odd question which it comes in. But that's fine too, kind of things. Okay, so as I said, in the verbal ability section, we will spend time on each of these areas in such a way that you are ready for solving first the two things. One is getting the answer right, and of course getting the answer right faster, so that you know how to eliminate. The methods of elimination will be spent, will be discussed in the class as such. Okay, so we have out of 22 of you here, Omkar and Nilay, I think, are the non-engineers, which would mean that if I'm saying verbal, of course, is going to be required for every one of you, Omkar and Nilay, you might want to really look at the GMAT quant section also, so that you go through the areas in that sense, right? Our plan, friends, for GMAT verbal, what is it that plan I do? Every week, starting today is what? Today is Thursday, right? So starting Monday or Tuesday itself, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday kind of things. 3 days a week, we will have these classes so that in the next 35, 40 days or 6 weeks at the max, we will finish the entire verbal area. The reason why verbal has to be completed before is because it requires a little more of solving, a lot more of practice than, let's say, a quant area. Quant also requires a practice, but they are more like, you know, formulae. And if you remember the formulae, a lot of questions become easier, unlike in CAT, for example. So those of you who have joined us for CAT, it's easier for you to, you know, probably look at the GMAT quant section. But GMAT verbal is where we want to kind of really, really give you the inputs which can give you a higher score. So we'll try to complete all the verbal classes by July 20th. Those of you who are picking up GMAT quant also, the idea is to complete by August 15th, obviously. Then the other thing that we plan to do for this particular batch, specific batches, every week, almost in a very daily basis, we will look at putting up these verbal questions even in a WhatsApp. So we will form a complete single WhatsApp group for all of us, for the GMAT students, so that there is a good sharing, you know, making a GMAT study group kind of things, so that everyone benefits out of it. We'll have the faculty members also in the same group, so that apart from the classes that are happening online in the live at this time of the evening, we will also ensure that almost every day you are, you know, not really bombarded with questions, but we make sure that you are completely, completely focused. The idea is to keep one completely focused for the next 4 weeks. Actually 3 months before you write the GMAT exam. Today we are talking about June 7th or June 8th, guys. July, August. I suspect that most of you would want to write it by August 10th or worst case September end in that sense. Those of you are planning to look at going abroad, you might have to write it by worst case by October 31st. So plan that. So Priyanka, the way we are planning to do is, those of you who have CAT also, we will give you the option to give you, say, CAT classes are going on in three different timings. There is a morning batch, 6:30 to 8:30, which is going on. There is an evening batch, like the same timing as 9:30 to 11:30. And for CAT specifically, we also have a weekend batch, where we have Saturdays and Sundays also. In that sense of the word, you, those of you who have a problem, can easily get, we can sort that out by looking at which timing that you can attend the classes to. The other thing which is very, very important, guys, whether more than anything else, which we want to spend a lot of time, which will help you to improve your critical reasoning, reading comprehension, and probably even sentence correction areas, is analytical writing assessment. So there are about 60 different topics of analytical writing. We'll take the class. In fact, next week itself, we'll take the class. And on a regular basis, over the next 6 weeks, each one of you will hopefully write at least 2 analysis of arguments per week. That's about 12 analysis of argument. One of us, either Rahul sir, myself, or Srinivas sir, we will ensure that we completely analyze your writing assessment, give you inputs and feedback on it so that you can keep on making it better and better. So that out of the 6 marks, if you can get 5, 5.5 in that, I think even if your score is slightly lesser, mind you this, even if your GMAT score is less than 800, let's say less than 700, but if you have an analytical writing assessment, AWA at 5.5, every business school will give you that value. Every business school in the world will give you the value. Definitely Indian business schools. So they know that, okay, boss, kahin mistake ho gaya hoga, but if somebody is getting 5.5, it's like fantastic. In fact, 4.5 itself is fantastic. So our idea is that we kind of deconstruct your assessment, writing assessments and arguments so that you develop a very, very healthy way of writing these things. Remember, this will help you in everything verbal that you do, not just for GMAT, but for CAD also. The other thing which is important, guys, whether, I don't know how many of you understand this, we have to begin the B-School counseling by mid-July, especially for, I'm not talking about CAT, but for ISB, for Singapore schools or the US schools kind of things. Those of you who want to go to any Stanford's and the Harvard's and the Wharton's and the Booth's of the world, please realize that the essays that you write are going to be far more important than just the GMAT score. So we also plan to do that in terms of figuring out which are the schools that you should start talking to. And it's not just applying. You need to also start talking to the professors there so that there is a continuous connection with those business schools if you want to get tomorrow a research assistantship or a teaching assistantship in those schools, especially the US schools. And we will ensure it is on a one-on-one basis, the SOP. In fact, SOP is going to be done by two of us, Rahul sir and myself, completely on this, where we look at your essays for the institutes in that sense. That's the plan for our next 8 weeks, guys, 6 to 8 weeks for GMAT verbal and counseling. Those of you are looking at the complete GMAT course, obviously the quant also will continue in that sense. But Latika, IR section will also be taken care of. But that's for the GMAT course in that sense. The integrated reasoning questions will also be taught over the next 2.5 months. It's about 10 weeks course that we ensure that everything which is relevant for GMAT will be taught. We have the two things. For integrated reasoning, etc., we have developed our own material. For areas like critical reasoning specifically, everything else is, developed in-house. But for critical reasoning, we are very honestly taking the original GMAT questions of the last 5-7 years to use that to kind of explain these things. Because critical reasoning, especially in India, you don't have as many good material as which we have. We have material, we have developed our material for CAT, but that is for CAT really. But for GMAT, there is a, you know, method in that entire madness. So we have really taken the official guide, the original GMAT questions which are available over the last few years, and put together a very decent plan, a decent class plan. But more importantly, it is not the question which is important. It is how to crack the question. How, what are the ways in which you kind of identify the crux of the argument and therefore get your answers. That's what we want, we are planning to do for you guys. Fair enough?